Peter 1. We're on the air. Praise the Lord. Last time we left off in chapter 5 of Galatians. We're talking about the freedom of grace. If we want to have freedom in Christ, freedom in our Christian lives, we need to understand God's grace and to be under His grace. It's not enough to know you're under grace and not under law. We need the ability to live it also. Amen? Praise God. So why don't we, why don't I read this here in Galatians chapter 5. We were talking about how the spirit and the flesh are contrary to one another and that you cannot do the things that you would. And so he says here in Galatians chapter 5 verse 16, if you would turn there. He says in verse 16, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill, bring to a completion, the lust of the flesh, the passions and desires. For the flesh lusted against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would." Contrary one to another. You cannot do the things that you would want to do to walk with God. But if you be led of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, they're made known, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, having a license to go commit all kinds of filthy sins, things that are in extremes, idolatry, praying to statues, praying to saints is idolatry, witchcraft. This word is translated into English from the Greek. It means pharmacia, pharmaceutical, drugs, witchcraft. Hatred, variance, emulations, a deep envy, strife and contentions, wrath, strife, seditions, as divisions, heresies, false doctrine, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelings, parties, and such like. The list continues. Of which I tell you before, and I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Why don't we pray, saints? Heavenly Father, we just come to your throne of grace, and we thank you now. We pray, Father, you give us your word. We don't want to hear me preach. We want to hear from the Holy Spirit. We want to hear from you, Lord. So help me, Lord, as much as you have given me and put in me, Father, stir up your spirit in me now. And prepare the hearers to hear your word, that it might fall on a good heart, on good soil, that it might produce 60, 80, 100 fold, Lord, to your glory. And we thank you, Father, in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. So, saints, the freedom of God's grace cannot be lived under the law. Now, I've heard good men of God, I've heard good preachers, but some of them, they have confused the law with grace. They've confused it. The Bible's clear. It says these are contrary to one another. They don't mix. It's like water and oil. It just won't mix together. They're contrary. They're opposite of one another. All right? That's why he says that in verse 14, "For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." This is how the law is fulfilled. Verse 13, he says, "For brethren, we have been called unto liberty," liberty, freedom, "liberty to do as you want to do, but only in Christ." Amen? We're not at liberty to sin. Only use not your liberty for an occasion to the flesh, for your lusts and desires, sinful desires. But by love serve one another, for the law is fulfilled, is completed in one word, in this saying, even in this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Amen? And if we don't do this, if we don't let the grace of God work in us, if we don't take in the sound doctrine that teaches us grace and to give grace to others, for us to receive it, to let it work in our lives, what's going to happen? Verse 15, you're going to bite and devour one another. Bite it like dogs, like animals. Take heed that you be not consumed, eaten up of one another. So he says, walk in the Spirit, a lifestyle, and you will not bring to a completion the lust of the flesh. See, our goal is to be conformed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Is it not? That's our goal. And we cannot attain to that goal. We can be deceived and think that under the law we're somehow getting to that goal. But you can't. You can't get to it. It's got to be through the grace of God. It's not possible. When Jesus himself came, he was grace in person. Grace personified. John 1:14. Right? He came as a man. He came, was born in flesh and blood. And we beheld his glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen? Grace and truth. God desires for such that we worship him in spirit and in truth. John chapter 4, when he talked to the woman at the well. Because it makes really no difference if you worship here or there. We must worship him in spirit and in truth. So, we see what the works of the flesh are. We see this world, it's in sin. We're in sin, we're born into sin. We've inherited from Adam. And this is what we do naturally. We commit adultery, fornication, all kinds of uncleanness, idolatry, witchcraft, drugs. That's a big one, isn't it? Drugs. All over the world. Look at even the pharmaceutical companies. Are just giving us all these drugs and drugs. I think the United States is drugged up beyond our understanding. The kids are on drugs. We're all on some kind of a drug. Witchcraft, hatred, variance, rats, seditions, on and on it goes. Partying, drunkenness, revelings. And the apostle here is very clear. Of the which I tell you before, and I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now notice it doesn't say, I've told you in time past, that if the lost do such things, they shall not inherit the kingdom of God. This is talking to saved people. Amen? This is talking to you and me who know the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I have told you in time past, that they which do such things, they shall not, they will not, they cannot inherit the kingdom of God. You will end up in hell. I'm talking to believers. See, a lot of people have taken verses like this, they're all over the Bible, Ephesians 5, and many other places, 1 Corinthians 9, lest I should have preached to others that I myself should be a reject. A castaway, rejected, disqualified. People don't get it. They think because you're under grace and God's giving you eternal life that you cannot walk away from it. You cannot send yourself into hell. That's a good way to put it, isn't it? But Paul, the Apostle Paul, is clear. I've told you in time past that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. See, grace gives us the ability to walk with God. It gives us the reason we can yield ourselves. It gives us the power to be able to have victory and overcome sin. Because if you're under the law, and our natural inclination as being flesh and blood and living in this sinful world and having sin in us, is to do these things. This is our natural inclination. That's why we have to continually read the Word, continue in His Word. That's why we go to church, to be accountable to one another. That's why we pray, so that we can have victory over these things. Amen? And it's not possible if you're trying to have victory and you keep condemning yourself. You can't do it. Why are you condemning yourself? Because you put yourself under a performance standard, under a law, and you keep failing because you cannot reach it. You can't reach it. Amen? You just cannot reach it. And see, this is the problem. This is why the lost people that don't know Christ, you know, they'll say, well, I'm not an adulterer. I'm not a fornicator. You know, I don't drink. I don't do drugs. I'm a good person. I don't steal. I work for a living. I do all these things. And what they're saying is, I'm good enough to get to heaven without Jesus. See, Jesus is okay. When I'm in trouble, I'll pray to Him. When it's an emergency, you know, like a parachute, I'll pull the rope, I'll pull the string, and the parachute will open in the emergency. But the rest of my life, I just live it the way I want. And when I get in trouble, a lot of Christians are that way too. Then I'll start seeking God, then I'll start praying, okay? That's not being led of the Spirit. That's not life under God's grace. That is, that's running to God when you're in trouble. And you can't even come to Him because you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Or you cannot have the fullness of the Lord in your life because you're still trying to operate under thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Instead of, hey, it's already paid for, my sins is finished, I'm a free man. And it's not that I'm looking at the law and saying, well, I better not commit these adulteries no more. I better not do these fornications no more. That's not freedom. Because that's what the law does. In Romans 7, Paul says the motions of sin, the actions of sin in our life become alive when we look at the law. That's why Paul said, I didn't know what it was to covet something, to desire with strong greed to have something, unless the law said, thou shalt not covet. So, what did the Lord say to Adam and Eve? Of every tree in the garden you may eat, right? But of the tree in the midst of the garden, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, the day you eat from that tree, you're going to die. What did they do? They ate from it. This is sin. Of course, the devil was there to tempt them, and that's what he's doing with us today. He's tempting us continuously, putting things in front of us, lying to us, deceiving us. And that's why, if you're under this law, listen, you're going to go down and you won't be able to get back up. You won't be able to get back up. But when you understand that, why don't we keep reading here in Galatians chapter 5, and he says in verse 22. See, after in verse 21, after he says, you cannot inherit the kingdom of God. You shall not inherit it. But verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit, the character of the Lord Jesus Christ, the character of God, His Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is love. God is love, benevolence, joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Peace. We can be at peace because He made the peace through His blood. Long suffering. God allows us to suffer long because he suffers long with us. Gentleness. That's a type of gentleness where it's not like you being effeminate or like a sissified man, but you can be gentle because you know the truth. You're confident. Amen? In the truth. And you can have a gentleness about you. Christ was gentle, and yet he was God. Goodness. Faith. Or faithfulness, meekness. This is a great word here. The meekness was the idea in the Old Testament was that whatever God did with you, whatever He did, you just took it and you gave him praise and glory, you received it from him, because it was from your own good. As Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Amen? And that is what meekness is. That is what meekness is, people. That we trust the Lord all the way. The scripture says that Moses was the meekest man on the face of the earth. Amen? Yet he had problems. He cursed. He hit the rock a couple of times, struck the rock a couple of times. He wasn't allowed to go into the promised land and all that because of some of the things that happened. But he was the meekest man on the face of the earth, the Lord said. Praise God. So because we're under grace, doesn't mean we're sinless, but it means that there is forgiveness of sins. Amen? Total, complete cleansing of sin. Complete freedom we have in Christ to serve him. That's the purpose of him. So we can serve him freely, not do what we want, right? So that's the fruit, the character of God. And they that are Christ, us that belong to Jesus, they have crucified the flesh with the affections and the lusts. See, that Jesus went to the cross, he was crucified, he died. The idea here is that when we trust Christ, this actually happens. God counts it this way, that your sin, you were there on the cross with Jesus, and you were crucified with him, you were buried with him. God is serious about this, and he rose from the dead, you rose from the dead, amen? And your slate is clean. And not only is it clean, it's not empty, clean and empty, but it's filled with the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Filled with the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every believer in Christ has this the moment they trust Jesus. But then if they're not taught the scriptures and how to live for God, for instance, when you're saved and you go to church and you hear somebody teaching you that you gotta keep these laws. Here's what it says. You know, don't fornicate, don't commit adultery, don't steal, and then you end up doing something wrong and you're condemned. Because all the law can do is show you that you're guilty, amen? Isn't that right? The law worketh what? The law worketh wrath. We're guilty. It's got no power to save you. The power would have to be in me to keep the law perfect. The power would have to be in you to keep the law perfect. See, the law is good. The law is holy. And if salvation could have been by the law, that's how it would be. But because of the weakness of me, my flesh, God's law is perfect. God demands perfect obedience to the law. Without that perfect obedience, we cannot enter his heaven. Only Jesus had that perfect obedience. Only him. Right? And he learned obedience how? By the things which he suffered. Amen? So if you're suffering, you're learning obedience. Amen? If you're going God's direction. If you're suffering and you're running from God, that's another story. You need to turn around and start suffering in God's direction. Amen? And so, like it says in verse 22, it says, against such there is no law. If you never broke a law, the law could never condemn you. If you know, the law cannot touch you if you're living right. Amen? It can't touch you. But we're sinners, we're in this world, and the mentality, see, because the world wasn't giving the Ten Commandments of Moses, but yet they would either accuse or accuse one another. Romans chapter 2. Why? Because God gave them a conscience. We're made in God's image. We know what's right and wrong. I know it's wrong for me to steal something from your house. I know this is, why do I know that? Well, I don't want that done to myself. Amen? I know it's wrong for me to commit adultery with your wife. I know that these things are wrong. I know it's wrong for me to go take a tree and make a god out of it and fall down and worship it. Why? Because the heavens declare his handiwork. And then night after night, utter its speech. It's all there. The creation is there. The conscience is there. I know there's more going on from the things that are created but are things I know in me, in my conscience of right and wrong. So they are without excuse. Romans chapter 1. We are without excuse. Amen? And so, to be able to live a life for the Lord has to be a life that has no condemnation in it. See, because the law will just, like a chain tied to your ankle, and you're dragging this heavy weight all the time, and there's no freedom. The burden's always on you, because you gotta be able to keep that law perfect. You gotta keep that law perfect. And if you sin, what are you gonna do? Now you call on Jesus after you sin? That's what most of us do. And we have to go through this kind of stuff sometimes for a long time. But if you will just come to Jesus now and just renounce. I want to take you through a prayer right now. The Lord has prompted me to do this. That you know Jesus. You've been saved already. You know His Spirit lives in you. You're struggling and you're fighting and you don't quite understand this thing of grace. Why don't you just pray with me right now? Heavenly Father, I just come to your throne of grace. And Lord, you've opened me the way to serve you by a free conscience, a clean conscience, without condemnation. No performance to be condemned for. That if I do wrong, Lord, I have the freedom to confess my sin and to repent and to be given strength by your Holy Spirit. Lord, right now, even though I might not understand all this was being taught, I ask you right now to reveal your grace unto me, to reveal the fullness of the Lord Jesus Christ and his plan for my life to serve you as a free man, a free woman, a free child, not to be under condemnation, not to have these feelings of guilt upon me all the time. Lord, I renounce those things. I tell Satan to get behind me. I want nothing to do with his ways. I want nothing to do with condemnation because he comes to accuse us day and night. And so, Father, I just pray those that are praying right now that you would set them free, Lord. Lord, I come against strongholds right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Strongholds of Satan that has put these chains on people's minds to keep them in fear all their life, from the fear of death, from the fear of failure, from every kind of fear, Lord. I just come against that right now. And I just condemn that because it's been paid by the Lord Jesus Christ. I ask you to set those people free. Those believers right now that are caught up in sexual sin, fornication, adultery, even homosexuality, whatever it may be, Lord, in the name of Jesus, right now I ask you, by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, cleanse them. Let them confess that right now and renounce it. Renounce those things, saints. Renounce them. Have nothing to do with them. Turn to God. Cry out to God, because if you don't, you will not inherit the kingdom of God if you die in your sins. So, Father, we just renounce those sins right now. And we ask you to be filled with your Holy Ghost and to reveal us the liberty and the freedom that we have in Christ to serve you, not ourselves, but to serve you. Lord, we pray for them that are listening to this right now. They're in jail. They've been knocked down so low. You're thinking about suicide, Lord. They're having a terrible, terrible time. You're listening to the radio right now in jail. You're watching this on a computer, whatever it is. And you need help. Cry out to the Lord right now if you don't know him. He'll save you. Cry out to him right now to fill you with his Holy Ghost. Lord, fill them. Comfort them according to your word, because your word is for real, Lord. Your word never comes back void. Touch these people right now, Lord, that are in the valley of the shadow of death, that are being pressed upon by demons and tormented right now, Lord. Father, set them free. Call out to Jesus. Go out. Cry out to him. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Hallelujah, Lord. And set many free. Set them free, Lord. Set them free. And I know you're being set free, people. God set me free. He sets all of us free. that come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Why don't we go to Romans chapter 4 right now. Romans 4. Continue on in Romans chapter 4. Now here in Romans 4, at the end of Romans 3, Paul says in verse 28, therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. He's talking about the Ten Commandments and all the other laws. Because some want to argue that he's not talking about the Ten Commandments, just a, don't eat this kind of fish, don't eat this kind of cow. Don't. No, he's talking about all of it. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not of the Gentiles, the nations also? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Seeing it is one God which shall justify the circumcision, the Jews, by faith, and the uncircumcision through faith. Do we then make void, useless, do we make void the law of God through faith? God forbid. In the Greek, that's a strong no. God forbid. Yea. We do what? What does it say? We establish the law. So the law isn't swept under the carpet. The law isn't you just throw it out and you're going to, because you're not under the law, you're going to live a lawless life against God. That's what many people believe, and they can't get free from that stuff. Right? But it says that when you are under God's grace, when you understand that by the law is fulfilled by Christ, then you start establishing the law. It's established in you. God's Holy Spirit came to live in you. We're not under a sacrificial system with animals that was given by a law, by priests who died and they had to get other priests. But we got an eternal priesthood here, the Lord Jesus Christ, after the order of Melchizedek, right? Amen? A never-ending priesthood. And it's not an animal that they sacrifice, but it's the eternal Son of God, God the Son in the flesh, that came, the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world, as John the Baptist said. So we established the law, because in him was grace and truth. See, Jesus came to confirm the promises made to the fathers under the Old Testament. So he had to keep the law. He had to do all these things. But once he got sacrificed and gave his life for the sins of the world, it says, and he rose from the dead, 9 chapters later, in Acts, he saves the chief of sinners, the Apostle Paul. Amen? And sends him out to the world with this message. God's grace. See, the truth is, the law couldn't save you, whether you were between Adam and Moses with no law. The law couldn't save you whether you were under Moses' law. And the law can't save you today. So how did anybody ever get saved? You were chosen by God before the foundation of the world. That's God's grace. That's the root of his grace. He had favor on you, unmerited favor upon you. Something you didn't deserve, for no other reason, not because anything was good about you, not because he saw in the future how good you would be. That's a laugh, isn't it? I mean, no, but before the foundation of the world, in his own mind, by his own will, he chose us. That's what it says. That is the root of God's grace. That's it, people. And so, the law isn't made void through this. How can it be made void through faith? See, you have to have faith. You read Hebrews 11. By faith all the time. By faith, Abraham went to sacrifice Isaac. Okay? By faith, he believed God, the promised land. He looked for a building, had 12 stories, whose builder and maker was God, the New Jerusalem. By faith, women received their men raised back from the dead. By faith, Moses refused the sin of Egypt, to be king of Egypt, a pharaoh of Egypt, to have sin for a season, but he rather chose the suffering of his people. Amen? He esteemed it a greater treasure. The parable of the great pearl found in the field. A man found his great pearl. He sells everything he has and he buys the field so he can have that pearl. That's what we got to do. We got to sell everything. That's what the rich young ruler couldn't do. He could not sell what he had because he would gain Christ. We need to, if we're going to gain Christ,